The way we collect that data is such that we're not actually exposed to things like names or email addresses. And so all of those things are essentially anonymized, first of all, on our customer's end. But then even beyond that, when we're analyzing the data, what we feed back to companies are aggregate statistics, you know, group level and above. And that's important for a few reasons. So first of all, that actually addresses the large problems that companies are really trying to tackle using our technology. Beyond that, it's provably anonymous. It's the sort of thing where if you just remove names, that's actually not anonymous. And taking this approach, not only again do we feel like it's the right way to do things, it's the most effective way to do things, it also has the advantage of being globally compliant. We can deal with data the same way in the UK, in the EU, in the US, in Japan, without changing our core system, and that's really critical. Specifically, you know, workspace planning, diversity inclusion, workload assessment, regulatory risk, collaboration and project delivery. So really looking at different sets of problems. But what's interesting, of course, is the data that drives those is almost identical. But it's really important, especially at first, as companies start to use this kind of technology. Remember, they've never looked at these kind of metrics before, to focus them in on the specific problem they're trying to address today. And then over time, you can expose them to more and more views on that data that can address most of the management decisions that they're thinking about. We don't ourselves design the layouts or anything like that. There's obviously folks much more qualified than I that can do that. But what our technology enables you to do is, first of all, understand, you know, what is the state of the world today? For example, how explicitly does the workplace impact how people are collaborating? And then what you're able to do is simulate changes in where people are physically located, the exact designs, and see how would that likely change how people work. Part of the challenge is that, for example, if we're talking about things like workspace design, typically HR isn't involved in that. Now they should be, but they're not necessarily one of the core drivers of that. Similarly with things like what communication tools people use, or even regulatory risk. Again, these are things where HR is typically brought in on the periphery, but they don't own that. And I think, from my perspective at least, for people analytics to be as effective as possible, it really requires cross-disciplinary collaboration within the organization. AI and tools like similar related tools like machine learning are important statistical tools that people should be using in some capacity, but we shouldn't overinflate their power importance. Really, the core methods within both machine learning and AI more broadly haven't changed very much since the late 80s. And really what has changed is the amount of data that we have at our disposal, which makes these things a lot more accurate. But I think that because these algorithms in specific instances are more accurate, it's caused people to certainly overhype and paper over the brittle nature of these algorithms, such that as soon as you slightly shift the context or you slightly shift the type of data you collect, these algorithms break down.